morning, and thank you so much, and thank you for joining True View as Julie and I talk today about living victoriously during turbulent times.
Jamie, I think there's one thing that everybody can be agreeing on, or at least a lot of people are, is that we are living in times unlike anything we've ever seen in our lifetime, and certainly I can testify. I've never been aware of a time when, as people would say, the foundations are crumbling. We're seeing the financial, every day you're hearing news about the financial, the fiscal cliff, but there's other issues, the moral collapse of our society and how things have changed dramatically in terms of what's the accepted norms of today and things that when I was growing up were considered to be the sins, the horrible things to be doing aren't just tolerated today, they're literally being embraced. And it's like if you're the person that's standing up against it, it's your view that's being marginalized.
Absolutely. And I just look at that and say that, you know, Isaiah says that there's a gross deception. When evil is being good, being
that's
called
right.
good, and good is being called evil, that's a problem.
And we've got a major problem today. And I think, as we're looking in America, we are having to understand that even our Constitution that we have so long taken for granted, that we can count on free speech, freedom of religion,
freedom to bear arms,
you know, everything that we thought, these things are stable.
Yeah.
And we're just seeing things start to crumble. And it can cause a lot of different feelings out there among the people.
Don't you feel like, I don't know if it's just you, but feeling like, oh my goodness, this is happening. And it's been happening for a long time.
It has. But there is an acceleration. I mean, if we look at it, we can say, clearly, there's been problems since the Garden of Eden when sin entered. You've got Cain and Abel. You've got, then it didn't take very long. You know, we're going at the beginning of Genesis and beginning to say that even at that point in time, we saw where Noah was saying that there had to be, or God was saying, I should say, to Noah at that point, I'm grieved that I even made mankind because there was such wickedness and violence that was going on. So yes, there has continually been issues where man, frankly, as we said, since the garden, has rebelled against a holy God and what his perfect commands are. But that acceleration, oh, it just seems to be going at a rapid pace. And the exciting thing in the midst of that is to know God told us. He told us in the Bible things would grow worse and worse as we see the end times approaching.
And just bringing up end times, which I think is so critical. Do you think we're in the end times?
Well, I personally do, Jamie. I don't think there's much question. But what does that really mean? I mean, we know.
Well, come on, Julie. I feel like people have been saying the end times for like 2,000 years.
There were at the time of Jesus.
I want to read this to you because I do think this is very interesting. And I'm going to read this article. Not an article, but just this. It's a paragraph. But it says, and I just want you to think this through as I read it here. Miraculous new communication technologies have suddenly appeared, transforming everyday life. Everything is moving incredibly fast. Globalization accelerates, Wall Street booms, and outside San Francisco, astounding fortunes are made overnight. The new media are partisan, marketing, spinning, and advertising extended their influence as never before. A fresh urban youth subculture has emerged, rude, and violent, entertainment fixated and violence glorifying media. Christian conservatives are furiously battling the cultural decadence, and the popular sect insists that the end is near. Anti-immigration sentiment is on the rise. Both major American political parties seem pathetically unable to deal with looming urgent issues of the day. And this was written, Julie, in 1857.
Well, it sounds like it's something that could be in today's magazines. There's no question about
that. It sounds exactly the same.
Those are the situations we're facing.
But when you look and go, this sounds exactly like what you would hear today.
Yeah.
The same things, even talking about the political parties. And I thought, oh my goodness, this has been the communication topic that's been going on. So to say the end is near, it's like, People have been saying that a long time.
Well, since the days of Jesus, literally,
yeah.
There were, you know, the disciples, and that was one of the things that made a difference. They lived every day with the expectancy that Jesus' return might be imminent. And I think God still calls us to live that way. I think what we can know for sure is that even though you people have been saying that for so long, what we were saying, Jamie, is the acceleration. It is coming at a greater intensity, the rapid pace at which these changes are coming, the suddenness that it's like overnight. It might be one day, it's one thing. And we, you know, we certainly can look even and say, during the last century, the end of the last century, we saw the fall of communism, for example. We saw, but the financial collapse of major savings and loans and banks and bankruptcies. But, you know, every day we're looking and saying, all right, so what, how many trillions of dollars are we in debt now? So there are some, definitely some differences. But I think the real question becomes, so what do we do? You know, but before we even get to that, what are people saying about that? You know, some people
it's a big deal.
Yeah.
Come on. They've been talking about this forever. And I think that article just proves the point that they say it's no big deal. Or a lot of Christians just go, you know what? What'll be will be.
Yeah.
And that's what it's going to be. So they just choose to do nothing.
That's right. And feel it's all so much bigger than me. It's so far beyond my control. I might as well just keep, you know, doing what I'm doing, and sometimes even to put your head in the sand and just say, you know what, since I can't do anything, I don't even want to hear the news. I don't even want to know what's going on. I've got enough to keep me busy with my family, with my work, with my schedule, with everything else that's going. I can't even begin to think about that.
Well, I definitely think that people do want to even anesthetize themselves.
Absolutely.
Completely, where they're just saying, I can't handle it. And there are certain behaviors that make me feel better, that provide that escape, whether it be escape into stupid sitcoms and TV shows.
Absolutely.
Or, you know, things that provide absolutely no value to your life, or things that can become even more reckless, like alcohol and drugs, and just trying to escape the realities of what is around us, because it can seem big and it does seem overwhelming. I mean, I know many women, especially in the Bible studies that I've done with others, where if you even start mentioning end time, if you say those words,
right,
it's like this clamming up, this uncomfortable.
Well, you and I have even had those conversations, you know, a lot of time where you're going, I don't want to know about this, or, you know, to hear.
Yes.
And I think it's because when you think that there's nothing you can do about it, you begin to think, well, I'd rather not know if there's nothing that I can do. But, you know, to me, that's the exciting thing, is to say God's word. Number one, it's told us to expect these times. As you know, as I said, the Lord has told us that things will wax worse and worse, or grow worse and worse, as we see those latter days approaching. But in another way, what God has also told us is we can know why these things are happening. And I think it's important for us not to stick our heads in the sand, and that we hear the truth from God's word. And we clearly have a nation that has turned its back on God. And there are consequences, just like they were consequences for the nation of Israel when they turned their back on God. And God said there really are going to be consequences for any nation. But Israel and America are the two nations that really had a covenant relationship with God. So we can really make some very much similar comparisons between the two. And I'm just going to call your attention to Deuteronomy 8, starting in scripture verse 19. If you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and worship and bow down to them, I testify against you today that you will surely be destroyed. Like the nations the Lord destroyed before you, so you will be destroyed for not obeying the Lord your God.
Now, I have a question for you.
Okay.
Just in hearing you read that, I know oftentimes you say, you know, if you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and worship and bow down to them. I don't see any big statues around here that people are worshiping. I mean, what exactly does that mean?
Well, it's not like the days that it was in the days of Nebuchadnezzar, for example, where he said, you know, and told Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you know, you're going to have to bow down to this statue.
But I oftentimes think that's what people are thinking.
Unquestionably.
In their heads are going, well, what other gods? I'm not bowing down to another god. I'm not
You're
praying
right.
to another god. So what does this really mean?
Well, I think the thing is, and I think this is one of the most important things for us to understand, there's idols in our heart. And those are the gods that we tend to worship
like
in America today.
What would be some examples?
I think one of the great, well, first of all, to me, the greatest idol is self. It's where we really think that we are in charge of our life instead of, and that our life is our own instead of the reality that we've been bought with a price. We were created by God for His purposes, for His pleasure. So when we put ourselves on the throne, we really become an idol in ourselves. But I think families, even that which is good can become an idol if we are putting our husband and our children above God. They can become an idol. But certainly when we look at our security that we put in our bank account or in our house or our job or our status, all those things are things that we may not physically be bowing down to, but we are putting ahead of God.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Because I definitely think that there just needs to be clarity. So when people hear that the Lord gets upset, you know, in seeing us bow down and worship these other type of gods, that we don't mean necessarily practicing
Absolutely.
A different sort of religion. It is really just putting anything
above
as more
God.
Important and above God. Well, just listening to all of this, one of the things that just comes to me that brings me such peace when we think about what's going on, and really, that last thing, it's not a good thought to think that the Lord does destroy, and He is a just and righteous God, that it also means that there's consequences when
there
we
clearly
deviate
are.
For Him. But what does bring me such peace and hope in knowing that is what He says in John 16.
I love that verse.
You know, in this world, you will have tribulation. It does not say, in this world, if you have tribulation.
That's right.
It is not an if. It is a when tribulation comes into your personal life or upon a nation. Be of good cheer. I have overcome the world.
That's
and
the
I
greatest
get so excited
news.
Knowing
Absolutely.
That. He's overcome it all already. So what are you afraid of?
That's right, Jamie. And that is one of my very favorite scriptures as well. And I think it also is an important one for us to realize. When we are facing those tribulations, they haven't caught Him by surprise. He knew that there were going to be problems.
Be of good cheer.
Individual problems, but there's also going to be some, you know, global problems. There are going to be things. And it's intended because we can come to the place of realizing it's way too big for us. But it is never, ever too big for a God who controls the universe, who's sovereign over every bit of it. And we can take joy in knowing that. And I think the other thing that, you know, He tells us what to do. And another verse that I think in Scripture, what I love about the Word of God, it tells us, like I was reading in Deuteronomy 8, why these things are happening. It tells us, like, you're looking then and how the Bible all holds together, where Jesus says in John 16, you can be of good cheer. But we can look in Psalms 11, and this directly applies to me to the days where we are today. And it says, in the Lord I take refuge. How then can you say to me, flee like a bird to your mountain? For look, the wicked bend their bows. They set their arrows against the strings to shoot from the shadows at the upright in heart. When the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? And we were just talking, Jamie, about how the foundations seem to be crumbling all around us. And I take joy in knowing God knew that the foundations were going to be crumbling.
And He knows your own personal fears.
He does.
Your personal fears. He knows the things that concern us. And He cares about them, no matter how small they are. And one thing that I just comes to my mind is I remember having a conversation with a girlfriend. And she said, you know, I'm really praying for this because this is a big deal.
Right.
I save all my prayers for the big deal.
Oh, isn't it wonderful to know He's involved in the details of our life, that there isn't anything too big or too small for Him to be concerned about?
And when we recognize that it's not just these big things that God wants to know and have us come to Him about, it's all the little things that cause us stress, that bring fear into our life, that helps us, like the title of the show, to live victoriously.
That's right.
When things either in your personal life or on a greater scale really seem to be shaking. There's some instability there. It's so good to know we have a God who is stable, who never changes.
And who's powerful and changes. Able to do something about it. I mean, I think as you're saying that, Jamie, about only taking the big problems, and I think for our friendship, if I only talked to you about the things that were the big problems, we wouldn't have a close friendship. But it's because it's even the small, the little things that we can share joys or concerns about that, you know, knits our hearts together. But the reality is, as close as I am to you, there's problems you can't do anything about. But what a joy to know I can go to the God who created the heavens and the earth and the sky and everything in it, who not only is big enough to take care of that, but cares about every detail, but he can do something.
And he warns us.
Yes.
I mean, just as, and I think of when you are raising children, how you know this is dangerous. This is going to happen to you if you cross this street. This is what's to come. And what I love about, I mean, so much I love about God's word, but what I really enjoy about God's word is knowing that it's the truth.
Yes.
And that he can tell us ahead of time what to expect so we're not surprised. And I just want to read 2 Timothy because he really nails it.
Yes, he does.
To where we can understand, okay, this is what things are going to look like as the days get worse. You know, you mentioned earlier, he already told us they're going to get worse. But I want to take a look at what does that worse look like?
Mm-hmm.
So it says, and I quote here, but mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, lovers of good, not lovers of good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying its power.
That pretty much nails right where we are. We kind of look and say, how could anybody hear those words and not say? That's even more when we begin to think about than the article you read that was, you know, from 1857 about what was going on. But I think the thing, again, too, Jamie, as we say, God's word itself is life-giving. It gives us that instruction. But the other place where we can look is to the example that Jesus himself lived. And to know that his word does say in John 18:37 that he came to earth to testify to the truth. He says that before when he's being under the trial before his death, that was the purpose he came. And we have to look and say, he calls us to also stand on the truth. And he wasn't afraid to confront the issues of the day. He even called the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He called them brood of vipers. He called them, you know, whitewashed tombs. We look and say that he was the one.
Oh, my favorite is he actually calls them, his father is the devil.
Absolutely.
Your father is the devil. And I think sometimes we get this idea, many times Christians will have an idea of Jesus as just being this sort of mousy guy.
Mealy mouthed.
That just, you know, roams about and is always never saying a mean thing.
Never confront an unkind
word.
Yep.
When, I'm sorry, but telling somebody their father's the devil, I don't know that that's going to get you a lot of friends.
No, and he wasn't afraid. And that's the whole thing, Jamie. He was never, ever afraid to tell the truth. But we also can know he only did that which the Father told him to do and spoke the words. But we can also know it was always with a heart of love. And because we don't have that kind of love, that the ultimate, it's like if you know someone is going off a cliff, to not tell them they're going off a cliff would be the most unloving thing to do. And that's why God's word warns us. And he does it in a way to get your attention sometime and to say, if you keep on this path, you need to know what is waiting ahead. Whereas we think, oh, it's only loving to tell people what they want to hear, but that can be the most unloving thing to do. And I think when we look at that in light of the times in which we're living, though, it's exciting to know that the same Jesus is the one that knew clearly that he was going to go to a cross on Calvary for our sake. But he didn't spend his time wringing his hands about that. He wasn't all concerned and upset, and it wasn't where he was debilitated and paralyzed by that knowledge. What he was resolute in carrying out his Father's will, knowing if his Father in heaven asked it of him, he could rely upon that being the very best thing. And it's that trust relationship. And Jamie, that's really what he's asking for us to have with him today, is to say, I have given you commands. I'm your commander in chief. There's a war that's going on.
That's right.
And you've got a mission to carry out. And the thing that's exciting is he's not only told us what our mission is, which is to go and share the good news so that people don't go off that cliff, but he's also given us the equipment so we can be ready for the battle. And I think that's so exciting.
And to think that the battle isn't only in your life when things are going bad.
That's right.
We have a battle every day. There is a spiritual battle going on above us in an unseen world. Scripture proves that time and time again. And knowing how good our God is, that he doesn't just tell us, hey, there's a big battle raging above your head for your very soul and for the type of life that you want to, you know, that I would love to give you. There's an enemy of that that does
Absolutely.
Not want you to have the joy I promise, the victory I promise, that wants to steal, kill, and destroy all that which is good that I have, that I want to give you, like
Absolutely.
Any good father would. And so he doesn't just tell us that, but then he says, listen, I've got some instructions
right.
on what to do, because this battle you face is a daily battle, whether your day, you're having a particularly good day, or the sky feels like it's falling. We have instructions that tell us to arm up.
Absolutely.
Get in your battle gear.
You're in a combat zone. And it's just like we wouldn't want to send our military out there without being prepared to face the enemy and to know about the enemy,
and
but to be equipped
yes.
to deal with it. So,
yes.
you know, I know that Ephesians 6, we are looking at that. Or when you look at that, you understand he has told us to put on the full armor of God. And that is critical that we're armed. And then
but
we look at every piece of that.
That is a key word, and I just have to stop you there. The key word there is to put on.
That's right.
Put on the armor of God. God is going to equip you with knowledge, with wisdom, with the strength and power to do the things he asks us to do. But there's still that enormous responsibility he's going to give you that says, but you have to do these things. I am giving you a choice here. And I'm telling you, you have to take and put on the armor.
That's right.
He's made the armor available, but if you are not spending any time at all to equip yourself with it,
you can't live victoriously.
There's no way you can do it.
That's right. You can't go into the battlefield and think you're going to win it if you've got all your armor sitting right next door to you instead of putting it on there. So as we look at this, and I think the armor we're looking at and is the belt of truth. You've got to have that belt, which is the central part. And that is what holds everything else together, and that's why he starts with it. You can't be living a lie. You can't be believing the lies. You've got to be in a place where you know what that truth is, and we know that the truth, obviously, is found in the person of Jesus Christ, who says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And there really is the plumb line of our life is always to say, okay, if Jesus says it, or if the Bible says it, if God says it, it's truth. I know it is to be true, even if I don't always understand it, but it's knowing that is truth. And then the second thing, Jamie, is that breastplate of righteousness. And when we look at that, how important that is.
The righteousness, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, he is covering each and every part.
That's right.
And you can't really have one without the other, because then you're going to leave a vulnerability
there. It's that full armor of God that we're supposed to be putting on.
And one of my absolute favorites is the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And when you think about a sword, you know, it cuts both ways. It cuts coming in and it cuts going out. And it's able, when you know the word of God, you can shred every bit of lies and false beliefs that come your way. So it's the only weapon God gives us that's offensive. And I also just want to mention, it's also offensive to many.
That's true.
To many. So just know, when you are equipped with that sword, you will offend.
And Jesus even said that while he was here, he offended many. Well, when I say the word of God says many were offended and left him. You know, he used to attract the crowds, the hordes of people who would follow him. But after he said the hard words, it specifically says in scriptures, but many departed. Because it was the hard word. And so you're absolutely right, Jamie. But I think the other thing that's in Ephesians 6 that we need to look at, that's so critically important at the end of all that, of putting the armor, it says, but you must pray in all occasions. And that goes back to maintaining that communication with the commander in chief. If you were on the combat field and you were fully equipped, but you weren't
continually
in communication with your commander, you still are going, okay, I'm ready, but what do I do? So you've got to have that communication. And the thing is to realize it is a two-way street. It is both talking to God, but it's listening. And going back, Jamie, you know, to the story that you had said before about in 1857, I think what's exciting about that article is that we can know that there was one man named Jeremiah Lamphere, and he knew about the times and what was going on. And like the sons of Issachar, he understood those times, and he took it upon himself to start leading people in prayer meetings. And he just started with a very, very small group of people. And from that one prayer meeting, it ended up growing like wildfire, and it ended up going across the whole rest of the nation. And what ended up happening is people prayed. And again, when you get your eyes focused on the Lord, and I so encourage you when you're praying, start your prayers with prayers of adoration. As you're doing that, you will be amazed at how small your problems seem in comparison to how huge God is and His ability to solve those issues. There's a old little song, "Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look Him full in His wonderful face. The things of the earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace." And what we are to do individually and corporately is to come to that place where we are taking our concerns in this troubled world to the Lord and listening to our commander-in-chief and hearing what He says for us to do. And it might be where He says for you to get involved in some political answer. But it is never going to be that that's the root. It's going to be the place where we need to just say, there is something that the Lord wants me to do. Will I be willing to do it?
Thank you so much for joining us today.
Joan Rivers with an important announcement. Getting old is horrible, okay? Horrible.
You're not old. I mean, you're older, but you're not old.
You want to see old?
Oh, God.
Yes. Grow up, for goodness sakes. The last man to hit on me was an undertaker. I know where
you know, I don't want to talk about
this. Well, you're going to have to talk about it. It's the future. It's coming right at us. And I'm not worried about dying. It's getting there. I mean, heaven is going to be fabulous. It's going to be a giant shopping mall, and there's going to be 20% off on everything, except for me, 44.
You know, you're doing jokes, and yes. I'm just not ready.
Well, you have to be ready. You have to listen to me. Look, there are things to discuss. They're going to be my needs. They're going to be my wants.
You know, Mom, I don't want to hear this. Oh, I just don't want to hear this. La, la, la.
Don't give me la,
no,
la,
no,
la, la,
no,
la, la.
I don't. I can't.
Talk
do this.
To your family about aging, even if they're not ready to listen. Mm-mm. Come on, listen to me. Listen to me.
For the first time?
Yes, for the first time.
No matter who you are, it's not easy talking about aging. For help, go to voa.org/talk. A message from Volunteers of America.
And now, another adventure with Savings Man.
Look, honey, it's my Social Security statement.
Oh, gosh, how are we going to retire on that?
Never fear, young savers.
It's Savings Man.
You need to save more. You'll need this.
Oh, the ballpark estimate worksheet.
That's right. Get it at choosetosave.org and find out how much you'll need to save for your future.
Gee, thanks, Savings Man.
No, thank you.
So visit choosetosave.org and stay tuned for more Savings Man.
My little brother is thinking about retiring.
I went to socialsecurity.gov to get a retirement benefit estimate. It was so easy.
When it's time to retire, you can file online.
I knew that.
They grow up so fast.
Savings Man here with a story for you about two young spenders named Tommy and Sue. Their parents let them buy whatever they chose, like video games and designer clothes. As they grew older, they spent all their pay on fancy cars, houses, two lattes a day. They lived in the moment, never saving a dime. When they tried to retire, they'd run out of time. Working forever is Tom and Sue's fate, so choose to save now before it's too late. Visit our website to find out more, 'cause a happy ending's worth saving for.